This is the first lecture on risk and return, and this is always the toughest unit for my on-campus courses, just because if you haven't had a lot of statistics, some of the terms such as standard deviation or covariance or volatility can be difficult to understand. So before you get started on this, I highly recommend you read the chapter in the book regarding risk and return, just to give you a stronger foundation. So here we go. Our goal for this unit is sort of describe the meaning of risk and describe some of the types of risk. We'll get to that at the end. Our first goal is sort of describe what a return is and understand what we're actually doing here with this risk and reward idea. So quickly to define risk, it refers to uncertainty. So in a finance concept, it's just the chance you don't get a payment or a cash flow that you expect. It's the chance that the stock might not return what you expect. And really, it's just the chance that things differ in their final outcome from what you were hoping. So, of course, some investments have greater risk than others because they have a greater chance of something going bad, like bankruptcy or project failure, or the project not returning enough cash flows. So the way we want to think of this is the greater the risk of an investment, the greater the reward our investors will ask for. You want to be rewarded for volatility or uncertainty. If I'm investing in something and it's guaranteed, say a bank CD downtown right now, you won't get as high a return because there's just not that much that you can lose. Okay? So that's our starting point or our premise. Let's define some terms before we move forward. So P0 we'll call the price of an asset right now in the moment. We'll call P1 the price of the asset in one period. We'll call D1 the dividend or the cash flow paid on the asset at time one or period one. And R1 will be the return we get on this asset. So we're sort of using the stock vocabulary here, but we could do this for any sort of investment. Now to start with, let's think of this in a time value of money context. Let's just think of the old future value of a lump sum. The future value in one period is the present value times 1 plus R. If we substitute in the terms we just came up with, our future value now is just the dividend in 1 year plus the selling price in 1 year. The present value is simply the price of the asset today. There goes my cell phone again, I'm sorry. And 1 plus R, R is the same as we've used in the second module. Now if we rearrange this equation and we solve for R, we get an interesting result. The first term is P1 minus P0 divided by P0. So if you look at that, that's clearly the change in price, you know, in the 1 year divided by the initial price. And then the second term is the dividend divided by the initial price. So our return comes from two sources. If we think about how we might break this out, the dollar returns on our investment would just be the numerator of what we just looked at. It would be the gain in price plus the dividend. And if I really wanted to scale this up, it would just multiply by the number of shares I own or the number of assets that I own. Okay, that would be the total dollar return. If I want to think about a percentage return that we just defined, we had our price gain component plus our dividend gain. If we further divide this out, our second term there is what we call a dividend yield. It's D1, or the future dividend, divided by the current price. So in other words, the dividend I get in 1 year, what percentage is that of my current price? The first term there is what we call a capital gain yield, or the capital gain return. We take the gain in market value for the asset, which is just the change in price, divided by the price we paid. So those two components add up to the return. Let's do a quick example, and then we'll talk about this in a larger context. So hit pause and read through this. So we bought 100 shares of Walmart a year ago at $25. If you read through the end of the paragraph, today the stock sells for $30. So basically we gained $5 per share in price improvement. That's our capital gain in dollars. So our capital gain yield, I don't have it calculated here, would just be 30 minus 25 divided by 25. Okay. Second part of our return is a dividend yield. It says 20% or 20 cents per share. So if I wanted to get it on a per share basis, the dividend yield would just be 20 cents divided by $25. Now we can scale this up for the 100 shares, which was what I do here at the end. So we multiply everything through by 100. So the price improvement was $5 per share times 100 shares, which adds up to $500. And then we got $20 overall in dividends. So we made $520 total. My total dollar investment would have been $25 times 100 shares, or $2,500. Now I put this example in just to show you how involved and a long process it can be if I really get caught up in the number of shares of an investment. A better approach is simply just to look at a one share return. That way, and do it on a percentage basis, that way we don't have to worry about how many shares we bought, we don't have to worry about the size of the shares we bought. We can just look at it, what did I earn on a percentage basis. Now the reality of what we just looked at is as follows. That was a one period snapshot of what the firm did. That was the return for that particular period. It doesn't say what it did the period before. It doesn't say what it's going to do next year. And that's the issue. What we want to learn to measure here is how the returns vary from period to period. And we call that the volatility of the stock. In this module, we're going to work on defining or calculating that volatility. And that ties into what returns we ask for in the future. The more volatility a stock has, the greater the return we're going to ask for going forward. So the point I want you to make here or see here is returns are far from certain. They vary over time. And what we'd like to talk about to close out this first unit is what is that volatility and what drives it? So why do returns change from year to year? Well, there's two reasons. We can break down why returns move up or down due to two factors. The first is what we call general economic risk, or a lot of times we call it systematic risk or market risk. It's just risk created by the overall economy. So things such as unemployment, perhaps war, terrorism, changes in tax policy, changes in Federal Reserve strategy. When these things change or adjust, or in our case, if unemployment increases or if interest rates go up, it tends to affect all firms. Now, it might not affect all firms by the same magnitude, but generally it affects them all in the same direction. So let's say unemployment goes down, which would be good news for our economy. Well, what we would likely see is that all stocks have a positive return from that, okay, or positive volatility. So that's called general economic risk. The second type of risk is industry or firm-specific risk. That's risk that's specific to a particular firm. So for instance, let's say Firestone. A long time ago, they had an issue with one of their tires, and they had some SUVs wrecked, and they had some lawsuits. Well, that drove down the returns on Firestone stock at that time. But you didn't see other businesses losing money because of that. So the point is there's volatility in everything. All right, that's just when your returns move up or down compared to what they do on average. Sometimes the returns move up or down due to changes in the overall economy or market, and that's kind of held in common by everybody. Sometimes returns move up or down based on something unique to the firm. Okay, more recent example of firm-specific risk, Apple has been losing market value here in 2013. The reason, Samsung is starting to catch up, and Apple's not growing as fast as they used to. But while Apple's been down, that's due to competition in Apple's industry, the whole stock market has been up. So the point is, risk is not always shared across firms, and that's called firm-specific risk. Well, where are we going to go from here? We're going to work on measuring risk. So our next unit actually talks about calculating historical return on risk. We're going to start building the concept of a portfolio and diversification. The idea that maybe we can get rid of parts of this volatility that we're kind of scared about. We're going to calculate this thing called beta. And conceptually, beta is fairly difficult. Mathematically, beta is not so bad, so don't be intimidated by it. And then we'll just get to the idea that if I know the beta of a stock, I can tell you what return we should ask for.